out there on Zoom this morning, and I am so excited that you are joining us today, because today is Baptism of the Lord Sunday, and we actually have baptisms today, and I'm really excited about that. That is something that has not happened in this congregation for quite a while. One of the things about small churches is that it doesn't come up that often, so this is a really unique and wonderful opportunity that we have today. I also wanted to just offer a very sincere word of thanks. On New Year's Day, COVID visited my house, and Annika is fully recovered and doing great. The rest of us have all stayed negative, which has been a huge blessing. But I just am deeply thankful for all of your lovely emails and the card that you sent to Annika, and all of that has just been really lovely. So thank you so much for all of that. It does mean, though, that this is technically only day 9 of the quarantine period. So I will stay masked the entire time, which I know for some of you, it's harder for you to hear me when I'm masked. But for the safety of everybody here in the sanctuary, that was the decision that we made. So hopefully you can turn the volume up on your computer and you'll be able to hear me just fine. A couple of announcements. So this week, Erica and I came in and we sort of undecorated the chancel area here, but the rest of the church still actually needs to have some undecorating happen. So this coming week, if anybody has a couple of hours that they would be willing to come in, just give me an email and let me know, because I think if there were just maybe 2 more people besides myself, we could get it undecorated relatively quickly. So I don't want to put a big stress on everybody to gather any more than that, just given our current circumstances, but it would be nice to have a little bit of help so that we can get all of the stuff properly put away and ready for when we are able to join together once again. We also have shifted our Monday Bible study to Zoom. So, and that's just gonna be also for the few weeks that we are shut down. So the link went out in yesterday's What's Happening. Those are always on the website, so you can go and check them out. And so hopefully we'll be able to see everybody Monday morning on Zoom for Bible study. So that is it for our announcements. So as we prepare our hearts, take in a deep breath and release in joy, because we have been loved since before the foundation of the world. So let us worship God.
Please join me in our call to worship. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of God's name. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of the Lord thunders, the Lord ever mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. Amen.
Every blessing, tune my heart to Let's join together now in the prayer of confession printed in your Bible. Creator of all worlds, we confess to sporadic beliefs and inconsistent faithfulness. Before the mystery of the universe, our minds cannot grasp a God who embraces infinity. In the face of natural disasters and cruel inhumanity, we doubt that love reigns. Between our own actions and the best we know, we see a wide gap that we cannot bridge. Oh God, reclaim us and help us reclaim our baptism. We need your healing, forgiving, and transforming spirit. Amen. Friends, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We have come to the time where we do our passing of the peace, which is a little unusual because we have so many people spread out right now. But I'll go ahead and read off a blessing of peace to those who have called in on the phone, and then I'll go ahead and pass the peace to those of you here in the sanctuary. It'll take a little bit less time because there's not as much of us to mill about as normal. So we offer a blessing of peace to Leslie and to Dawn, to Ethel Hamilton and Jan Olson, and to Russ and Phyllis. So may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. So let's go ahead and offer our prayer of illumination.
Please join me in our prayer of illumination. O God, on the earth's first day, you caused the light to shine out of darkness. Now flood our hearts with light from your word. Lord Jesus, Son of God, you are the light of the world. As we read and speak and listen, shine in and through us. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Isaiah, Chapter 43. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. I give men in return for you, peoples in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offsprings from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So friends, we have the unique honor of being able to practice a sacrament that we don't get to do that often. And we are doubly blessed because Lily and Jonathan have invited Jonathan's father, the Reverend Charles Bowdler, who presides over a congregation in Mississippi, to fly up here and do the baptism for his granddaughters. So we are just so honored that you are here, sir, and that you get to come up and be a part of this really beautiful and wonderful tradition and sacrament here today. So we have, actually, go ahead, I'll invite you all to go ahead and come up. So Lars, go ahead and put it on chancel view so that you can see both ends of the chancel here. And normally this is a sacrament that is done obviously in the place of the entire congregation, where we do have that because we are over Zoom and everyone is here. And we also have one of our elders, Martin Jimenez, is also joining us on Zoom. So I will do the invitation and then Martin will have the opportunity to do his role as a member of session. And then we will move on from there. So there will be a little bit of moving of the screen for you as we get all of the parties available. Hear these words of Jesus from the Gospel of Matthew, an invitation and a promise that is offered to us all. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. In the sacrament of baptism, God gives us a new identity as God's people. In a world that is turned away from its creator, where anonymity and rootlessness threaten our existence, God calls people into covenant embrace. God called Abram and Sarai, gave them new names, and promised to make of them a new nation through which God would bless all the families of the world. They would light the path home for all humanity. In the fullness of time, God sent Jesus to be our Savior. In his death on the cross, our old self is dead and buried. In Jesus's resurrection, we rise to a new life and look forward to a new creation. When we are baptized, the Holy Trinity seals our adoption as God's children and places God's name upon our bodies and souls. Through baptism, we have a new identity in Jesus Christ. So at this time, I'm going to make it so that the people in the sanctuary can hear him. Okay, so Lars, you need to mute the sanctuary.
On behalf of the session, I present Hazel and Chloe to receive the sacrament of baptism.
The sanctuary. There we go. And now we will do the questions. So Lars, if you can please make sure that it's on chancel view and not pulpit view. Thank you. So Jonathan, we have the questions for you and for Lily. I recognize Lily has stepped out with Hazel for the moment, but we will have you sort of represent the two of you together here. So, having heard God's gracious promise to us in Christ, do you desire that Hazel and Chloe be baptized?
We do.
Do you renounce all forces of evil that rebel against God and sinful desires that draw you away from the love of God?
We do.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, we place our trust in Jesus.
Do you intend to be Christ's faithful disciples, trusting God's promise, following Jesus' word, honoring the church, and showing the Holy Spirit's love to others as long as you live?
Yes, with God's help.
Will you devote yourself to the church's fellowship and spiritual formation for yourself and that of your children, joining in the breaking of bread and prayer within the community of faith?
Yes, with God's help.
Let me just take just a brief moment to thank Reverend Carlson for welcoming and for allowing me to participate in the baptism. I'm very grateful. It's a joy to be here. What is your child's name?
Hazel Elise.
Hazel Elise Fowler, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And what is your other child's name?
We're going to do the verse.
I'm sorry, I forgot the verses. Go ahead.
The Bible verse. So we picked this one out for Hazel. It's Proverbs 31, 25, and 26. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. Yes, and for Chloe, we picked out Psalm 57, 7 and 8. My heart is steadfast, O God, my heart is steadfast. I will sing and make melody. Awake, my soul. Awake, O harp and lyre. I will awake the dawn.
And what is your child's name?
Chloe Calliope.
Chloe Calliope Bowden, child of the covenant. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called children of God, and we are. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, shall ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We welcome these newest members to the family of faith today. It's very exciting.
Very exciting.
Would you like to offer a prayer over them?
Yes, let us pray. Oh Lord our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. We give you thanks and praise for the gift of this beautiful day, a day of Sabbath rest for the people of God. We thank you for the gift of life and the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Lord, we're thankful for the church, our spiritual mother on earth, and we're thankful for all the means of grace that you give us, the preaching of the word and the sacraments in particular today. And we thank you for these two children. Well, Lord, we pray that sealed by the Holy Spirit and baptism, that all of the benefits and blessings of the covenant of grace would rest upon them, and that they would grow in knowledge and wisdom and favor with you and with others. So we bless them this day in your name, and we are grateful for their lives. And we pray for special grace for their mom and dad, too, and their extended family. Help them as they train them up in the wisdom and knowledge and fear of the Lord. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, friends, we now come to the part where all of you participate in the blessing of this sacrament. In the Presbyterian Church, we don't assign godparents because all of this community commits to supporting and encouraging the life of faith, both for Jonathan and Lily, but also for Chloe and for Hazel. So while all of you are at home, please look into your bulletin and we'll recite the part in bold when we get there. So friends, we now receive Hazel Elise and Chloe Calliope into Christ's church. I charge you to nurture and love them, to assist them to be Christ's faithful disciples. With joy and thanksgiving, we now welcome you into Christ's church, for we are all one in Christ. We promise to love, encourage, and support you, and to help you know and follow Christ. Amen. With great celebration, we are so honored and blessed to have these two beautiful new members of Christ's church. Thank you. And thank you, Reverend Bowdler, for coming. I really appreciate it. Thank you, Beth. That was lovely. Our second scripture today comes to us from the book of Acts, starting in chapter 8 with verse 14. Now, when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. The two went down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet the Spirit had not come upon any of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So today is Baptism of the Lord Sunday, and not only do we get to celebrate the sacrament with the baptisms of Hazel and Chloe, but we mark this day as a time where we get to reflect on our own baptism, because our familiarity with this particular sacrament is often extremely limited. Theologically, our church accepts that parents can make the choice to be baptized for their children, and that, as we just did, we vow to come alongside them as a family and help support the spiritual formation of not only the children, but their parents as well. And if there is a downside to that particular doctrine, it's that for most of us who were raised in the church, at where we experienced infant baptism, then we don't generally remember our own baptisms. It's not the norm. So the only time we get to experience it is when we see the baptism of children, or on Baptism of the Lord Sunday, where we sort of hold and reflect it. Now, in a smaller church like ours, we can go years between celebrating baptism in the sacrament of its fullest. This particular year, we are going to be doubly blessed because Martin's family is going to be baptizing their son Valencio here on Easter. So we have another one coming up, which I'm super excited about. So we will get to reflect on it more in the coming year. But what I wanted to do is take today and really be able to kind of dive a little deep into what it is that all of this means. Because our sensibilities about baptism have changed over the millennia. And as we read in this little snippet, it's a very short pericope for us today out of Acts, and it's that in the days of Jesus and in the early evangelism of the disciples, baptism was done by adults, for adults. And it was an act that brought them into this new community that was the way of Jesus. And for Peter and John, it is something that they are still mostly limiting to their fellow Jewish believers, until Philip starts talking to the Samaritans. And just before these verses in Acts, we learn about Saul, who is basically sort of hunting Jewish believers and started just really persecuting those who are becoming baptized and even killing the disciples who are going around and speaking the gospel. So we are encountering this broad spectrum of ideologies, even within these two short verses, where we have Jewish believers that are being targeted by their own church for believing in Jesus. We have core members of the 12, like Peter and John, who are still believing that the message of Jesus is really meant for the Jewish people. And then you have Philip, who is encountering this strong thirst and hunger for the message of Jesus Christ among people who are not Jewish at all. And you may recall a couple of weeks ago that we talked about how initially, baptism was a rite that was practiced on those few people who were converting to Judaism. And so for John the Baptist to be practicing it on people who were already Jewish had sent this very big disruption into the religious leaders of the time. And that was part of why John was particularly targeted in his time. And now in these years following Jesus' resurrection and ascension, the practice is serving as a way that someone demonstrates that they have sort of washed themselves clean of the darkness that they have participated in and are dedicating themselves to living this life of radical love that had been demonstrated and messaged to them by Jesus. It was physical and personal. It was an intimate act that was also a symbol of their renewed personal connection to God. As we saw today, baptism is this beautiful moment between a human soul and their creator. And it has blessedly not changed, even as we have continued to debate and battle over our own understanding of it. But what happens next? Once we have been baptized, what does that mean? Is there anything more to be expected of us, other than for us to talk about it every January? Now, you may recall that the last Sunday of Advent, I was not here. I was serving as the lead administrative official for Pacific Northwest Swimming's Senior Championships. Now, admins, or AOs, are known as dry side officials, which means we get to work as swimming officials and not get wet, which is a big deal. So our role is to certify all of the times that are coming in. So we handle disqualifications and we're processing the results. And in a champs meet, like the one that I was serving at, just like the Olympics, swimmers compete in preliminary races to qualify for finals. So finals are only allowed for the top two, sometimes three heats. And when you race in finals, that's what determines your ultimate place and the points that you score for your team. And in most of these meets, there's just two heats of finals. And so after your preliminary race is over, those top 16 swimmers have their names read aloud in the pool. And from the moment that their names are read aloud, they only have 30 minutes to scratch out of finals. Now, why would they do that? Well, some swimmers compete in a whole bunch of prelim swims, but they might want to focus their final swims down to one or two where they are apt to place highest. Sometimes a prelim swim is actually really fast, and so they might feel like that's the time I want, and I'm probably not going to swim that fast if I do it again in a few hours. So they just take that prelim swim and they scratch out of finals for that reason. But you have to scratch, because if you don't, and then you don't show up to swim, that is what's called a no-show penalty. And often this penalty means that you are disqualified from your next event. But in really big meets, like national level meets, you can be removed from the entire meet. So the expectation is that everyone who makes it into finals will swim, unless you specifically tell us that you won't. And if you don't show up, there's a cost in that moment. You must choose to either scratch or swim. And part of my job as an AO, as an admin official, entails that for every swimmer who scratches, that then I move up the lower ranked swimmers to fill their spot. And so if you don't scratch and then you don't swim, there's a cost to the other swimmers in the community, because they've lost their opportunity to race, to place higher, and to score points for their team. And that's why the penalty exists. Not because we want to punish the swimmer, but because their choice impacts others. Now, when we are baptized into a community of believers, there is a covenant created not only between you and God, but between each of us. We take this gift of water and the Spirit of God into our souls, and it transforms us. It fills us with the expansive love of Jesus. It is a gift that we receive from God, and it is not something that we are meant to keep to ourselves or even our small, tight circle. And that's also the lesson that Peter and John receive in our scripture today. See, even in these early days of our faith, there has been this struggle to see God's love and favor in its full expansion. Saul didn't like these new sort of Jesus way folks messing up what it meant for the Hebrew people to be God's chosen. Even the disciples struggled with that idea, believing that Christ's message were for these same people, but perhaps those people alone. So when they head out to Jerusalem, from Jerusalem to Samaria, excuse me, where these people are responding so powerfully to the gospel and saying yes to this way of Jesus, they have this tangible experience of the Holy Spirit moving through them and into these non-Jewish believers. And in that moment, they are confronted with the undeniable truth that God's love is for all people without limitation. And that's why baptism is not truly a one and done kind of thing. For Lily and Jonathan, for Hazel and Chloe, and for every single one of us, baptism is just the beginning. With the movement of water and the laying on of hands, we have received an understanding of what it means to be loved deeply, exactly as we have been created. There is, though, a second part, which is that we act out of that same gift through our choices, actions, and the love of our fellow human beings. The expectation is that we will show up to swim. Unfortunately, many of us haven't. And the cost of that choice often impacts others more than it even does ourselves. Now, it may be that for a period of time, you feel the need to scratch out. Maybe you're encountering doubt, frustration. Maybe you've experienced spiritual abuse or crisis. And the fullness of your baptism isn't something that you can show up for right now. And that's okay. See, swimmers who scratch from an event are still swimmers. They still get to show up and swim another day. In fact, by scratching from a race, they allow someone else to step up. And so for all of you, and I know that there are many of you out there who join us online, for whom church is a very difficult place to enter or to be a part of, know that you are still a beloved member of God's family. And that's what makes baptism so amazing to me. It's this constantly flowing promise that surrounds us and moves within us and is shared among us. God gifted us with this promise, and we use it to gift one another. It's both communal and unique to us. It flows out of us into the world, and it pulls us home on gentle waves. It's part of our identity and also a specific choice we make to love and be loved. Children of the covenant, you were baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, one God, mother of us all. Please pray with me. Gracious and loving God, you surround us in warmth and connection. You have blessed us in our baptism. You have called us forth in your love. And even in all of the movements of the world, and the difficulties and joys, the celebrations and the heartache of your church, we remain connected. Connected to one another and connected to you. Help us to live into the fullness of our baptism by sharing that gift with others, especially those for whom the gift may not feel as gifted right now. Help us to be present for one another. Help us to share your love through our words and our deeds.
and help us to be expansive, to recognize that all people are your children, and that in that family we find hope. In your holy name, amen.
So as has been our practice when we are mostly on Zoom, our offerings are collected online, or they can be mailed straight to the church office. The address is both in the bulletin, but it's also available on our website. So please pray with me over our collection of the offerings. Gracious and loving God, you inspire us to move into the world, to carry your word of hope and love everywhere we go. As we collect our tithes and our offerings this day, help us to be mindful of where those gifts can be served best. Help us to be generous in our hearts and with our resources. In your holy name, amen. So friends, today we have the opportunity and the blessing to be able to practice both of the sacraments that we hold in the Reformed tradition, that of baptism and of Holy Communion. And as with our baptism being a covenant with us as joining part of God's family, this table offers the promise between us and Jesus that as long as we follow and listen and hold close in our hearts, Jesus will nourish and provide for us. For it was on the night that our Lord was betrayed that he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, pouring it out, saying, "This cup is my blood shed for you, sealing
the holy covenant of my forgiveness for sin. For as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So friends, we have a few people in the sanctuary with us today, so we will serve communion to them. And for those of you that are joining us on Zoom, you may partake of the bread and juice or whatever it is that you have available to you in your homes. That is how we have practiced it throughout the pandemic. So we will continue to offer that. So we'll take a moment and we'll have communion for here in the sanctuary. Peace of Christ. Please pray with me. Gracious and loving God, you connected us through two blessings, through the sacrament of baptism and through the sacrament of your holy meal. We hold these as sacred moments. Moments that connect us with you, and moments that connect us with one another. Help us to continue to live into the beauty of your church, wherever it is we may find ourselves. In your holy name, amen.
Take me to the water, take me to the water.
Well, friends, your charge this week is to go forth in the fullness of your baptism, knowing that you are loved not only by God, but by a whole community here. May the God of all creation bless you and keep you. May Jesus Christ make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Holy Spirit lift up her countenance upon you and bring you peace. And all of God's children said, Amen.